So, we keep hearing the messages over and over again, the need for, well, the need to keep on sticking to the path of spend when it comes to infrastructure. After all, this sort of spend is needed not only to keep the oil, the economy well-oiled and ticking over, but also the country needs these projects in order to function, in order to be able to provide to your needs and to the needs of businesses for many, many years to come. So the point is, we heard earlier about the do not panic suggestion, and it's really key to things like infrastructure spend. You cannot put a stop on it. We just heard that the government can keep going for the next 2 to 3 years. My question is, what happens in about 3 to 5 years if the price of oil stays where it is, if we see other black swans on the horizon? After all, we had an ISIS attack in Saudi Arabia very recently. We've got the situation in Yemen now going on. So we actually don't know, of course, what the future holds. But the question is, how is what's going on around the Sultanate of Oman going to affect what you're doing here over the next few years? Right. Well, to discuss infrastructure development, the way ahead, please join me in welcoming to the stage the CEO of Oman Power and Water Procurement Company, Engineer Ahmed Bin Saleh Al-Jahdhami, the CEO of Al Jazeera Steel Products Company, Dr. Baskar Dutta, the Chief Economist of Oman Investment Fund, Fabio Scatiavillani, I hope I said that correctly, the Managing Partner at KPMG, Khalid Ansari, the COO of Omran, Lubna Al-Kharousi, and Partner at Ernst & Young, Rajiv Singh. Ahmed, may I please start with you? You know, as I said earlier, what you're doing is key for this country. You cannot suddenly put the brakes on and say, oh, oil price is down. What are we going to do? Budgets are cut, that's it. You can't do that, can you? You have to keep chugging ahead, full steam, in fact. What's the situation?
Indeed, we are. There's no brakes. Actually, I think we are going full speed this year. We have more projects than ever, at least in the power and in the water sector. And that's mainly due to two reasons. One, if I may say openly, is that we have come out of the tender board process, so we can do things much faster. I think everybody from the, at least government, maybe I shouldn't have said that. But I think last year, all the government companies have come out of the tender board process. And just to give you an example, we had, you know, it took us nearly 2 years to do one project. And this year I had around seven projects, you know, tendered in 1 year. So it just gives you the sort of the pace that things go and the change that we need as well within the government entities, if I'm allowed to say openly. So no breaks on the power or water projects. We have plenty of projects. Unfortunately, these projects will take time to be implemented. So I think at least on the water projects, we have around five projects that are, a number of them are targeted towards 2018. And we have a number of projects that are fast track projects and some are slow track actually, it's a bit delayed. But we are hopefully this year we'll be opening or commissioning a number of projects on the water. On the power, we've just recently signed the Salala project yesterday. We have another project that was around 445 megawatts, new capacity plus an acquisition of an existing project, which is 270 megawatts. We have a project in Musandam, which we'll be signing soon. It's already, we're progressing on it. That's 120 megawatts. And we have in tender right now 3,200 megawatts to be commissioned in around 2018 and 2019. On the water, we have just, we have a Ghubra project that we are hopefully, it's unfortunately been delayed. And we are hopefully commissioning it this year. But we have Quriyat IWP, which will be commissioned in 2017, and that's around 44 million gallons a day. We have just now two tenders that are live, and that's for around around 50 million gallons in Barka, sorry, in Sohar, and 60 million gallons in Barka. We have two expansions that we've negotiated on a fast track in Barka to cater for the current situation. And we've also negotiated on Sur another expansion. And we are going for another project in Sharqiyya and also in Salala. So there's plenty
of work. My goodness, there's a lot going on. Right. So the question is, why is it all happening now? Why didn't you do it earlier on? But okay. That's a different discussion. My question to you specifically is, though, that are you going to pay those who win the tenders on time?
PWP, Oman Power and Water Power Company, I think we have a lot of audience here from our contractors or the project companies, and I think we're very well known for keeping to our time. And, you know, we have a saying in Arabic, it's actually a hadith, أَعْطِ الْأَجِيرَ أَجْرَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَجِفَ عَرَقَ. So, you know, you have somebody working for you before their sweat dries, you have to pay them. So we are very famous for that, at least. I don't think that will be changing. I think the key thing in the power sector that we need to replicate in other sectors is that we are involving fully the private sector. So all of the power projects and the water desalination projects are done through private sector. It's 100% private sector ownership. And we also require them to put on public offer, an IPO, within 4 years from establishment, around 40%. It used to be 35, we increased it to 40% of the shares to the public in Muscat security markets. So I think that's been very successful. It also involves everybody within Oman to be shareholder in the sector. And we think, I mean, humbly, we think that this could be replicated, and we hope that there is a push to try and learn from that. For sure, there are learnings that we continue to try to improve on, but that's, you know, we're always open for learning.
Of course, you know, people like me want to have people who have issues and problems and broken promises on stage. It's much better, isn't it? And what I was going to say is that you're sort of like the golden boy company of the sector. Yes, go ahead. Do you want to say something?
I'm just going to embellish on what Ahmed said. So on the generation side, I think absolutely great role model. We do work across the region, and we always talk about the Oman power sector model as a great benchmark case study for people to look at. So on the generation side, I think Ahmed's absolutely right. They involve the private sector, pretty much self-sufficient, great track record, excellent. But if you roll back a little bit and look at the power and water sector more wider, so of course the challenges for the government is a much larger base of investment. When you talk about transmission, you talk about distribution, you talk about sector reform, where do we go? So I think whatever Ahmed's doing on the generation side, so probably 2x on the rest of the sector, I would imagine that's the sphere we're talking about. The challenge, of course, for the government then to look at is, if you're talking about that sector, so we're talking about, I don't know, $15 billion maybe in the next 5 to 7 years, is that doable? What is a priority? What gets pushed back? So some of the challenges are going to be more interesting on that side, not so much for Ahmed per se.
Right, and in fact, I'll come back to you to give us a big sort of helicopter view of what's going on with infrastructure generally here.
Okay, so I think the key thing when we talk about infrastructure is to define what is infrastructure. Personally, I run Ernst & Young's business for infrastructure advisory in the region, and we say we focus on three key sectors. We talk about transport, number one. A lot of push we see in the region, and the same you see in Oman, on railway. You see that as a great enabler, something that should contribute to GDP over the long term, but is going to suck in a huge amount of capital in the short term. So which means you need to put in a lot of money. You talk about Oman, possibly if they do everything that they want to do, that's possibly $20 billion at least, that's just railways, yeah? So that's what it's going to take. Are you going to get return on that on day one? Obviously not. You're going to put in all of this money. It has its impact on other sectors over a longer time, so transportation becomes easier. Foreign companies want to come in. Logistics, which we keep saying, is a great sort of competitive advantage for Oman. You unlock that, so that's something to look at. Roads we talk about, yeah, so we want to improve the road infrastructure, agreed, across the GCC in Oman, you see that. So overall, transport as a sector is going to be by far the largest spend for the government. We need to look at that. Second, we talk about social infrastructure. What is our definition of social infrastructure? Healthcare, we know for a fact. Again, we talk about Oman, but same is across the GCC. A lot of investment needs to happen on healthcare. Healthcare spend as a percentage of per capita GDP in the Middle East, in Oman, among the lowest globally, when you want to set global best practice benchmark. So you need to see a fair bit of investment in that sector. Second, we talk about education. Again, a lot of investment required. And last, we talk about social accommodation, social housing, yeah? So we talk about how do we enable these to happen. So that's social infrastructure for me very quickly as being more relevant in this part of the world. There are other elements around globally. And the last, we talk about energy, so which is power and utilities that Ahmed and his team look at. And the other is for the oil and gas companies and mining and what's happening in that. So those are the three broad sectors where we see the largest spend happen for infrastructure that is relevant to this region.
I'll go to you, Fabio, first, and I'll come back. So you have a great insight,
hopefully,
into what's going on with basically spend in the future. What money is going where? Please share.
But you know, these the economies of the GCC essentially are built on a very simple model. The main activity is oil and, in general, hydrocarbons extraction, which then are recycled back into the economy through the intermediation of the government, which owns the hydrocarbons and the energy resources. This is done through two main channels. One is the civil service, so the let's say current expenditure, providing services to the general population, and the infrastructure, which builds the endowment, the capital endowment for the country.
But I mean, I'm asking you specifically because you are involved with the Oman Investment Fund.
The Oman Investment Fund comes, you know, a bit outside this main framework because we manage some of the proceeds from energy exports with the aim of developing the non-oil sector. So we are one of the engines, or we try to be one of the engines of the diversification issues that we that you were discussing in the previous panel. Diversification means that you need to find what are the most competitive areas where Oman can develop, and pinpoint what are the main issues that prevent the development on of the non-oil sector.
What's the answer?
The answer is you need infrastructure is one of the issues. The second point is that nowadays the economy, the global economy, is a knowledge-based economy. In other words, the highest value-added activities come from human capital, from sophisticated human capital. So that's the other key soft infrastructure, which we've been pointing out here. And so these will be the two pillars of diversification. And in these, on these two pillars, we as an investment fund can build the prosperity for future generations.
And are you, again, how has your behavior changed, if at all, as a result of low oil prices?
I don't think there has been any particular change for one key reason. In the past few years, in the good years, the government has pursued a rather prudent fiscal policy. So there has been an accumulation of resources, of financial resources, through government budget surpluses, which give a breathing space, I would say, a substantial breeding space for at least a couple of years to go through the this negative oil shock. So at present there hasn't been any major slowdown. Clearly, if this this oil shock would persist for more than 2-3 years, which I don't think it will, then things need to be reassessed. But at present, pretty much we are on the same course we were last year because of the buffer built through this prudent fiscal policy.
So are you saying to everybody in the room, don't worry?
You see, both in policy, in economic policy, and when you manage a business, there is always, I would say, a good advice to follow, and it is this: treat negative shocks as permanent and positive shocks as temporary. So people must worry, must make plans, contingency plans, in case the oil shock will persist for longer. So one, you see, whenever you do a 5-year forecast for your business or for a country, you must always be sure of one thing. During those 5 years, 1 or 2 years will be bad years. You don't know which one. Nobody can tell you. Economists cannot predict which year will be the worst over the next 5 years, but you must be always ready to take up the challenge of being in a recession or in a negative environment situation. So the advice is this. The A plan, if you wish, is we'll go through this bad spell of low oil prices, but still make a B plan in case this will persist. In any case, there is a factor that will help go through this these two couple of years, I would say, of lower oil prices, and it is the fact that interest rates are low. So the government, when the buffer gets thin, can resort to borrowing because rates on international markets are very low, and actually it's very convenient at present to be on the debtor side rather than on the creditor side.
So as the fund, basically, what are you? How are you implementing what you just said to the room?
But we, you know, we have an endowment of money that we are using to make the non-oil GDP portion larger. So that's our mandate. How do we do that? Well, we want to attract technology, know-how. We want to make sure that the resources are allocated to those sectors that not over the next 2-3 years, but over the next 20 or 30 years will be driving the economy. We want to bank on the competitive advantage of Oman, which are those that you probably are all aware of, such as tourism, logistics, downstream petrochemicals, but we also want to push for a knowledge-based economy. We want to attract high-end manufacturing. We want to attract healthcare. We want to expand, for example, in the environmental areas, such as waste management, clean tech, and so on and so forth.
Can you say to us that, hand on heart, there will be no cutbacks on infrastructure spend, even if oil price stays low for years to come?
For years, we need to define a number.
Five years. I don't know. You know, we keep on talking about 2 to 3 years. We've got enough money to last 2 to 3 years. What happens after that?
What I would think will happen is this. For the next 2 or 3 years, there are projects like, such as the Batina Highway, the railroad, that the power, water, that will go on. It would be absolutely, it would make absolutely no sense to stop things halfway, because it's much better to borrow and complete this project rather than leave an empty construction site to gather dust. So the projects that are being underway from the airport to the ports to the highway, etc., will be most likely completed, unless there is a major world shock, which at this point is a black swan, but you cannot make decision fearing black swans. If in, let's say, 4 to 5 years, the situation wouldn't go back to normal, I think there would be a reassessment on the priorities. This means that you need to conduct a cost-benefit analysis on the major projects and see which ones carry the highest benefit and then assign priority accordingly. That's what, you know, prudent economic policy and prudent management of public money dictates.
Okay.
I was just sort of going to have a slightly different view. I think I agree that infrastructure spend has to be high on the priority, but I'm not too sure if any governments are prepared to wait even 3 years of depressed oil prices. My view is 1 year of depressed oil prices are going to be enough for people to look at those projects and start looking at prioritization immediately. I get the sense, and I'm not just talking about Oman, I can talk very confidently at least three of the GCC governments. We see that very clearly. Because I think if you look at the shopping list of the governments and look at what they have, these are very, very large numbers, because what's on the shopping list right now is based on approvals that went through to H2 of last year, which is the second half of last year, when oil prices were still sort of $130 plus. So those projects have been approved, but there has to be a prioritization, and I believe it will happen much sooner. That's just a different point of view.
And in fact, you've actually touched upon a point which I wanted to make, which is that we're talking about projects and budgets that have been approved already.
Correct.
From a very brief chat here, and also chats elsewhere, projects coming to light now, they're not getting approved. So, you know, you're still reaping the benefits of what has gone.
But I think, you know, that's your queuing order, your stacking order. So projects that are coming on light, so where do they rank against projects that got approved some time back? So if projects that are coming right now are higher priority than the projects that got approved 6 months ago, 8 months ago, then obviously they will stand the test. But if it's a new project, which means presumably they are lower in the order, they will go through a much stronger commercial scrutiny to say, is this really needed? I can talk about a specific example, and I won't name, but a nearby GCC country, where there is a $5 billion road and bridge project because they wanted it to be an iconic project. Yeah, so which is great. 8 months ago, with the oil and gas prices, everybody would have liked that. You put yourself on the map. But today, they're looking at it very seriously. They almost at one instance canceled the project, and now they just come on to us and saying, can you do a study, look at value engineering, and tell us, is this really going to be commercially viable? And at some stage, we need to move on to the next stage of the discussion, saying, does all of this need to happen on the government payroll, on the government bankroll, yeah? Which is to say, how do we get private sector involved in helping us implement some of these projects? And the analogy I like to give is, it's no different to your household, yeah? So if you're thinking about your household income, and you, of course, let's talk about a young family, household income of 3,000 riyals, you want to go and buy a new car, you want to buy a new house, you want to buy a new lot of stuff. So if you've got a lot of, your bank balance looks really positive, you'll say, yes, I'll go and buy that by writing a check. And the other way you're going to sort of say is, can I get financing on that? Yes, or can I get into some sort of an installment scheme, which still allows me to do that, but I'm bankrolling on that future income. And that's, I think, a great opportunity for the governments to look at. Personally, again, I keep saying when we are running the infrastructure business, high oil prices were a dampener because we said governments are not that keen on PPP because their budgets look so great. But with depressed oil prices, great opportunity for the government to look at private sector participation. How do we get private sector participation come in? Can private sector bankroll some of this? So I have annuity payments which are spread out over a 20-year horizon. So take Ahmed's, again, case, great case study. So if he was to build a power plant on his own, and we can talk about, let's say, the sewer power plant, it would have cost him, I don't know, maybe about $2 billion, $3 billion, somewhere around that ballpark. Against that, if he's got, let's say, 15, but let's say for to round off easy, we say 20-year concession, he's going to pay out maybe $2 billion a year. So suddenly he's not writing a $23 billion check right now, but he's writing maybe $200 million check every year, but for 20 years, which allows him to build that project, and which is how he can go ahead and this year put 7 projects out. But if the government had to write an EPC check for each of his 7 projects, you would not see 7 projects. And that's a great successful story to look at and say, can this be replicated in other sectors? Can we do this with roads? Can we do that with education? Can we do that with healthcare? And a number of other sectors.
And in fact, I want to ask Lubna now, what's happening in your sector, tourism? I mean, it's constantly cited as one of the great saviors, you know, when it comes to diversification. How are you doing it? Are you doing this sort of partnership, et cetera? What's going on? Where are you getting the money from?
Actually, we're reviewing the way that we do the funding for the tourism sector. And the way that we're doing development has been reviewed basically last year. So previously, the government would develop single assets. So a hotel here, a, you know, rest area there.
What was the catalyst for this?
Basically, the government has decided that tourism needs to be one of the key drivers for the diversification of the economy. And so what is now the mandate of Omran is to develop master plan destinations and cities. And the difference that this creates is within infrastructure development, so within our entire program period, we can save about $3 billion on infrastructure spend. So by creating a destination that has, you know, a clustered area, you don't need as much infrastructure as going to other random areas. The other thing in terms of how the clustering benefits the economy is that, of course, when you have a critical mass, the contribution to GDP and job creation is greater. And the way that we also look at our prioritization of projects is what is the impact or the multiplier effect on induced and indirect GDP contribution and job creation, either through SMEs or through the supply chain. The other thing that has changed in the past year, and this isn't necessarily as a result of oil price dip, it's really about the scale of which Oman wants to focus on the tourism development. And it's looking at alternate sources of funding. So, for example, I mean, just with the 2 of our hotels, we've started to raise financing for, which in the past, you know, as Omran, we would never raise financing for a project the size of a hotel. We also look at PPP partnerships. So we have a number of joint venture investments with regards to development of, you know, ITC projects in large-scale areas. And the partnerships are, you know, in the past it was predominantly international investors, whereas now we're also focusing on inviting local partners to invest as well. The next component is within our master plan development. So if I take, for example, Irfan, which is going to be the new downtown of Muscat, the role of the government or Omran is going to be primarily to set up the structure and the infrastructure for it and the key iconic or attractions within the development. And then those land parcels will be passed on to the public, to the private sector to develop. So it's not that we're gonna build the entire new downtown of Muscat, it's that we basically set up the framework and then everyone else in the private sector has to come and participate.
Okay, we'll delve into tourism and diversification later on in the discussion. I just want to go to Bhaskar in terms of hands-on, practical, you know, you, where you work, you roll up the sleeves, you're in the thick of it. It's a port, you're making things, you're having to deal with all sorts of problems if you don't have enough water or electricity, or if there's too much regulation. What's it like doing business here?
First, for the infrastructural development, I think for a company like us is the best beneficiary because we are supplying the steel for these projects and we look forward for the infrastructural development for which we can survive also. The biggest issue that comes in today is the regulations that are there, especially from the point of manpower. I'll just give an example from my own plant. We have a seniority scale and we are trying to get the locals into a higher scale. But for them, for that, they need to be trained. For 1 year, I'm looking for a people, asking all the people down the line who wants to venture into this superior career. No one is interested to come. This is a problem that is being faced mostly by the industries over here. So this is a problem which has to be really dealt with from the HR ministry point of view or from the Labor Department. The issue over here is a background of education is also required, and I seriously think that people who are coming out from the schools, they should be in the, you know, seventh or eighth grade, should be going and visiting the factories and understand what sort of a situation in which they have to work if they don't really use their brains and go up in the brain category and go for higher education. They'll be limited to the brawn category, and automatically they have to get involved in the work which is 100% being done by expats. You have to replace the expats, and it's becoming very essential to replace the expats in this level with local enterprises, but then local workforce. Unfortunately, that eagerness we find very much lacking in the industry. However, with the expats, we are being able to roll and make money. And today, the effect of the union is having a lot of effect on that, and HR ministry has to really take a call on how much. The other thing that we feel is that, you know, in the neighboring states, they have got a quota for taxes. If you have total locals, the tax regime is the lowest. If you have some combination, the next tax regime. If you have a higher combination of expats, higher taxes. So if this category can be made in the industry, it'll help. But that doesn't solve the problem of getting the locals employed. So it's very much required that the locals need to be made to understand from the working stages that they have to go up the ladder and pick up more responsibility, and they have to inculcate a proper work culture.
And there's another issue when it comes to manpower, though, which is being able to bring in the necessary manpower if there isn't the legal, the legally available manpower locally. How many companies here have to bring in manpower from abroad? Maybe you're involved with infrastructure projects, you have to build things, or you're opening up shops. How many companies here have to bring in overseas manpower? I'm amazed. Very. I would assume everybody, right? I mean, come on, where are the hands? Is it easy? Yes, raise your hand. Is it easy?
No.
No, no, it's not easy. I mean, just today, I didn't read the article, but the front page had, is it 1,000 workers?
Yes.
And it's about building the airport, that the airport will still be built on time, so on and so forth, even though you've just lost 1,000 people. My guess is, those 1,000 people were working because the work had to be done, that penalties would have to be paid out if things weren't done on time, but they couldn't get the workers in easily or on time. Fleeting conversations indicate that it doesn't matter how big or small the company is, it is a very challenging thing, I'm being diplomatic here, to bring in workers as and when needed.
Can I just add on that? I think also from a government perspective, there needs to be an awareness of the cost implications of delaying projects. And this is somewhat lacking. Whereas I understand, and I'm Omani and I fully am for Omanization, I think in terms of, for example, our projects, if you don't have the labor force to be able to build a major structure and it gets delayed for a number of years, then the revenue to the country and the implications on the GDP are significant. And so we need to move away from looking at compartmentalized issues and saying, for example, we can only tackle manpower issues, or we can only tackle visa issues, and look at it from a comprehensive government perspective of what are we trying to achieve as a country in terms of diversifying the economy, in terms of how it being a contribution to the GDP, in terms of making sure that you have industry and projects available that will generate jobs that are actually of interest to the locals.
So it's about joining up the dots. And very briefly, Khaled, I want to turn to you just to give comment. I mean, you've seen various things over the course of your career. When are we going to see this joining up of the dots?
I think the oil price shock will wake up people, and that's where joining of the dots would happen. The challenges which we've all talked about is primarily because most of the organizations or the ministries are working in a silo. For example, the Ministry of Manpower, it's its own silo. It's not communicating with the Ministry of Commerce or the private sector. So one would hope that the lower oil prices, pressure on cash inflow, would make people start thinking and cooperating and get out of the silo mentality. Problems would be there, but it's all fixable. There are challenges of employment of young Omanis, but there are solutions also. So if there's a knee-jerk reaction, it sends a wrong message. This is, you know, as Dr. Hatim was saying, this is the fourth oil dip I'm seeing since 1986. Economy has come out of it in 86, in 98, in 2005. The net result was that companies or organizations which were not profitable, which did not take action, went out of business. New companies came into business. Today, you see companies which were not there in 1986, which are larger companies. The larger companies in 1986 are not here today because they did not change with time. So the silo mentality will have to be...
You see, my question would be, though, there's a difference between a company like Kodak going out of business, for example, even though they invented digital, the ability to actually be the future, because of an internal issue, myopic internal decision-making process. And there's a difference between that and between what can happen in this part of the world, which is I'm going out of business, not because my books aren't in order, I'm in the black, but actually my bank account is in the red because I'm not getting the cash flow, because perhaps I'm being squeezed, because perhaps I've been fined and penalized because I had to employ 1,000 people illegally. I mean, do you see where I'm going? It's not just about the internal process. Companies can be very affected by external issues, government-led issues that they cannot.
And there are instances, for example, if especially in your working in a construction infrastructure business, where you're totally dependent on payment from the government. If there is a slowdown in the payment, obviously it'll affect the companies. And that has been happening in the past. This is where you need to come and work with the banks together to look at projects and say there are financing required. I think the company should not shy away from borrowing. Government should not shy away from borrowings in a bad cash flow situation. You have to borrow.
But
the challenge is that if you slow down today, it'll take you another 3-4 years to pick up the momentum.
But one question I don't know if you can answer or somebody can perhaps enlighten me. What percentage of businesses go under due to the sorts of issues we've been talking about, which are bureaucracy and red tape related?
I would say if you look at the rate of bankruptcy or liquidation or closure of the businesses, large businesses have not gone under. There are no major bankruptcies other than, I can remember, out of the last 30 years, 3 bankruptcies. What has happened that businesses have been forced to take actions such as mergers, join hand, reorganize themselves. If you look at 1986, the number of banks which were in operation at that time, very few are in existence today. Few of the banks today have been merged, and 4 or 5 banks merged to become what is Bank Muscat today. So action has to be taken. The reality is that the businesses are driven by cash flows and profit and bottom line, and that will dictate the economy and the businesses. Government is not dictated by bottom line. Government is dictated by expenditure. So there's a mindset change between a businessman who looks at top line and bottom line and a government who only looks at expenditure and cash coming in from oil. I think that's the challenge, and that has to be bridged.
But what the government decides can make or break a business.
Yeah, I think I was just going to add, sir, while Khalid is right in saying probably bigger businesses are better equipped to weather such storms, it's the small and medium contractors who get depressed. And I don't know if Mr. Marubi is still around. There's been a lot of examples, small and medium-sized contractors are getting squeezed out in the past with delayed payments, with issues, red tape. So they've gone bust, and there's a lot of examples. And you can see possibly similar issues in the construction sector. So those are the businesses where margins are low. They're dependent on cash flows moving at a certain speed. That gets slowed up, payments get delayed, you've got claims that worked against you. And those businesses are fragile and they can easily tip over. The other thing we don't talk about too much is you also have a lot of international businesses that come here to do a couple of projects before they decide to set base and set up permanent establishment. So some of those guys, if they've lost money, they would just say, okay, we're not going to come back again. So you do see that, and I think there are enough examples of that happening in the past, no doubt.